Hey space fans, and welcome to Space Chat. I'm Chelsea, and here at Space Chat, every week, I take a deeper look at Earth, the universe, and beyond. Now, this week, I'm going to be exploring missions to Mars, as this month, three separate missions from three separate nations are arriving at the Red Planet. In fact, recently, the UAE's Hope craft, the nation's first Mars mission, entered Mars orbit, and China's Tianwen-1 mission also arrived at the Red Planet. These come about a week in advance of NASA's Perseverance rover, which is set to land on Mars February 18th as part of the agency's Mars 2020 mission. Now, just a reminder for those of you new to Space Chat, every week I dive into a new topic, sometimes I have some fun special guests that join me, and I take some time to answer your questions. So if you ever have a question or comment about space, about the great cosmos, send it to us, post it on our Twitter, on our Facebook. I would love to know what you think and what questions you have. So let's talk about missions to Mars. Tuesday, February 9th, the United Arab Emirates, the first ever Emirati mission to Mars, successfully entered orbit around the Red Planet. The spacecraft, dubbed Hope, launched July 19th and, after firing its thrusters for almost half an hour, I think it was about 27 minutes, it did that to slow down, the craft was able to slip into Mars orbit, thus making the UAE the fifth entity to ever reach the Red Planet. This follows NASA, the Soviet Union, the European Space Agency, and India. Now, in May, Hope will be relocated into a new science orbit around Mars that will allow it to circle over the planet's equator every 55 hours, thus giving it a really great and unique vantage point, allowing it to study large-scale atmospheric phenomena on Mars. Now, the Hope mission is set to last 687 Earth days, and in addition to studying the planet's atmosphere, the UAE hopes that this mission will inspire youth across the nation. Now, just one day after the UAE's Hope probe entered orbit around Mars, February 10th, China's Tianwen-1 mission, the nation's first fully homegrown Mars mission, entered orbit around Mars as well. This makes China the sixth entity to get to Mars. Now, the ambitious mission isn't just an orbiter. In fact, it includes both an orbiter and a lander rover duo that will land and explore the surface of the Red Planet at a later date. The lander rover pair is aiming to land in Utopia Planitia, a large plain in Mars' northern hemisphere. Now, the mission's orbiter will study the planet using a high-resolution camera, a spectrometer, an ice mapping radar, among a number of other instruments. Now, the lander will help the rover to not just land, but it will also deploy it. Now, this rover is not China's first. In fact, it follows suit after China's moon rovers, Chang'e 3 and Chang'e 4. In fact, the fourth is still driving around, rolling around on the moon today. These achievements come just a little over a week ahead of NASA's Perseverance landing. On February 18th, NASA's Perseverance rover will land in Jezero Crater, an ancient delta on the surface of Mars, as part of the agency's Mars 2020 mission. Also launched this summer, the rover was sent to Mars for a variety of scientific and exploratory purposes. With the rover, researchers will test the first ever Mars helicopter, named Ingenuity. The rover will also collect and cache a whole bunch of samples of Martian regolith, or Martian kind of soil surface material. Those kind of cached samples will be retrieved and returned to Earth as part of a future mission. And with the success of caching and returning those samples, this will be the start of what is set out to be the first ever successful sample return Mars mission. And the mission, it goes without saying at this point because it's just so exciting, has a really important and exciting overall purpose. With Perseverance, NASA hopes to, once and for all, find concrete evidence of life on Mars. Now, what exactly that means, we have yet to see. Will we find concrete evidence that 3.5 billion years ago there were microscopic organisms living under the ground on Mars? Will we find something different entirely? Is it possible that life could still exist in some form or another on Mars? We do know that for periods of time, liquid water can, in small amounts, exist on Mars' surface. We know that it has water ice at its poles. There are a lot of things about Mars that continue to raise questions about its current and past habitability. So, to discuss a little bit of that exciting science with me, and to also explore what scientists and engineers at NASA do to ensure that we protect missions like Perseverance and protect both us and planets we travel to from things we might accidentally pick up along the way, I have a special guest with me today. Today, my special guest is Mujige Cooper, the lead planetary protection engineer for Mars 2020. And Mujige is here to help me explore this mission and help explain what planetary protection is and why it's so important as we branch out to the red planet. It's almost February 18th, which is when NASA's Perseverance rover will land in Jezero Crater on the surface of Mars as part of the agency's Mars 2020 mission. Now, I'm here with Mujige Cooper, the lead planetary protection engineer for Mars 2020. Thank you for joining us.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me.
Of course. And now, as we're getting closer and closer to this landing, how are you feeling as someone who's worked so closely with the mission?
I'm, as you can expect, very excited. It's like different chapters in a book. I mean, we were extremely excited, especially during the launch period, but now that it's landing, I mean, this is yet another part of history being cemented. So I'm just extremely excited and ready for the science to start.
Absolutely. So you are the lead planetary protection engineer. For those who might not know, what is planetary protection and what does your job look like with Mars 2020?
Yeah, planetary protection is kind of twofold, and I love to equate it to going to a national park where there's the leave no trace policy, right? When we go and we explore different planets to include Mars, we want to make sure that we're not bringing any microbial hitchhikers with us that may contaminate the surface of Mars or may affect our science. And then the second part is, eventually, we hope to bring these samples back. So we want to make sure that we protect our own Earth's biosphere from any inadvertent contamination, too.
Absolutely. So specifically with Perseverance, it's no secret that one of the main goals of the mission is to search for signs of life on Mars. So I assume that your job would be more important than ever with this mission, as we don't want to risk contaminating those samples.
Yeah, exactly. And the thing is, I mean, similarly with robotics, once it leaves Earth, your job is done. So everything that I and my team have done to ensure that these containers are clean, that's going to acquire these samples, it's already done. There's nothing more I can do, actually. So yeah, we worked so hard to make sure that it was all assembled, clean, tested, and launched in a clean manner.
Absolutely. So you mentioned before kind of the two sides of planetary protection, the both don't bring anything extra, but also don't bring anything extra home. Now, you know, we can look back to the Apollo days and they were concerned with astronauts coming home with moon bugs. And we're clearly past that. But especially seeing as this is a mission looking for signs of life on Mars, what does that look like in terms of bringing those capsules home eventually with the second half of this mission?
Yeah, well, the conversations are ongoing and it's far above my head, right? Because in order to bring the samples back, there's an international collaboration in the works. Not only NASA, but the European Space Agency and other government agencies need to be on board to make sure it's done in a safe manner. And that's the number one priority. There are going to be a lot of checkpoints, and if it doesn't meet that safety checkpoint, it's not coming back. So at least, even though the conversations are ongoing, we could all be assured that everyone's trying to get this done in the best way possible, in the safest way possible.
Absolutely. So obviously, you know, Mars 2020 is a NASA mission. How do other agencies and companies like SpaceX or Boeing Do they have to adhere to the same planetary protection guidelines and rules kind of set by things like the Outer Space Treaty, or do different agencies and people have different rules?
Yeah, that's a really great question. And because the United States is a signatory, private companies do have to abide by planetary protection rules. The thing that made it a little bit more difficult to abide by it is, you know, with NASA, our goal is to have the best science possible, to do the right thing. And it's not, we don't really focus on the profitability of having a return sample. And understandably, with a private entity, you have to make sure that things are accessible monetarily. And so, yes, they have to abide by the same rules. And on the flip side, we have to do a good job in making sure that it's accessible monetarily to those companies who really can't afford a steep science project per se.
Absolutely. So you said that, you know, pretty much because the spacecraft, it is well on its way and set to land, that your job is kind of done in terms of ensuring the planetary protection safety of the craft and the mission and its science objectives. So I assume that at this point you can really be excited about the science and the mission. And I'm curious, what are you most excited about with Mars 2020, with Perseverance, with all the amazing science that's going on and going to happen?
Yeah, this is such a difficult question because there are so many things to be excited about.
No pressure.
Yeah. I mean, there are so many answers. For example, the prospect of sending humans to Mars is going to be that much more achievable because we have MOXIE there that's turning the CO2 into oxygen for fuel and for breathing air. I think my favorite thing is the sampling and caching system, which is the whole suite of instruments from the robotic arm in the interior to the robotic arm on the exterior, the coring drill, all of the parts that need to work together to acquire that piece of chalk-sized core is going to be my most exciting part that I'm looking forward to. A lot of my friends work on the sampling and caching system and work on the test bed to make sure that this is done in the right way, and I'm just excited for that first sample to be collected.
Absolutely. So you mentioned crewed human missions to Mars. Obviously, planetary protection will look a lot different for an uncrewed robotic mission versus a crewed mission. What kind of challenges do you anticipate, and are you already working on those challenges with future crewed missions to the Red Planet?
Yeah, there's the landscape of planetary protection definitely changes once humans go there. I like to say we're more microbes than humans. If you count the amount of microbes on and in our body, it's more than we have human cells. So we are a nice petri dish, if one were to summarize it as something. The landscape would change. It would definitely require more conversations, especially on the international scale, to really make sure that we do this in a right way so that we kind of try to contain the amount of contamination that humans bring to Mars when they explore it. There's still more decisions that need to be made. But yes, it will change.
Absolutely. So I just have one more question for you, but thank you so much for taking the time. I really appreciate it. I know everyone is really, really excited about this mission.
Yeah.
So I think that as we continue to launch robotic missions to Mars, there are three just this month, Perseverance being just one of the craft to land at Mars in February. I think a lot of people who might not be in the space sector or be scientists, they might wonder, why are we doing this? Why are we going to Mars? Why are we exploring another planet? Why don't we just continue exploring Earth? Why are we going to all this trouble? And I am curious, as a scientist, as an engineer, how you would answer that question.
Yeah, and I would say that is an extremely valid question. And there are multiple reasons why we would explore our closest neighbor. First of all, it used to be habitable. That's what the Curiosity rover did confirm scientifically. So we need to understand what happened, and can whatever happened to Mars also happen to Earth? So it's a really great case study to understand there may have been an impact in the past that threw everything off. Whatever it may be, we need to make sure that we understand it so it will help us inadvertently. We're, you know, a little bit selfish, right? Of course, we can explore, but it does have benefits for Earth. Not only that, a lot of the technology that is developed to do this kind of space exploration directly benefits people on Earth and allows us to do better exploration of nooks and crannies and deep oceans here on our own planet. So it's not mutually exclusive.
Absolutely. Well, thank you so much, Mu. It's been really wonderful at kind of hearing about your journey and the side of the story. And I cannot wait for Percy to land on Mars.
Yeah, February 18th. Let's all watch together.
Awesome. Thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
Yeah. Thank you. Thanks for having me.
All right. Thank you so much, Mujige. I really, really appreciate you coming on and talking with all of us here. Now, this leads me to the next portion of Space Chat, the question and answer. For those of you new to Space Chat, throughout the week and in advance of these episodes, people send us questions over social media, we get emailed questions, we get all kinds of questions from all over the internet. And at any time, whenever you have a question about space or about an upcoming episode, feel free to send your questions in. So I have some questions here that people have sent in about Mars and about some of these upcoming missions. So let's dive into them now. All right, the first question actually relates just back to the planetary protection conversation I had with Mujige. Someone asks, what dangers are there in a mission to Mars like NASA's Mars 2020 mission? That's a really great question. So obviously Mars 2020 and the landing of the Perseverance rover, it's totally uncrewed. There are no astronauts on the rover. There are no astronauts that were launched along with the rover. A completely uncrewed, zero crew mission. However, that does not mean that there are no dangers. And you know, obviously we're not going to be harming any passengers because again, uncrewed, but we're going there with the explicit purpose of finding signs of life, right? When we launch a mission like Perseverance, planetary protection engineers like Mujige work really hard to make sure that there isn't any microscopic life accidentally hitching a ride to the red planet. Now, this may not seem like an obvious danger, but it could endanger the science, right? If we're looking for signs of life on Mars, but instead we detect bacteria that we brought from Earth, it could compromise and jeopardize the entire mission's integrity and any science that we could end up doing and data that we collect on Mars. So ensuring the safety of the craft in so that you ensure that we're not bringing any extra passengers, microscopic passengers along, is extremely, extremely important. Also, While Perseverance is not a person, there is a lot of danger in landing on the red planet. I forget exactly what it is. It's the 7 minutes of terror. I'm just kidding. Yeah, 7 minutes of terror. when rovers, at least in the past few recent years, have landed on Mars like Curiosity, NASA dubs a period of time during the landing the 7 minutes of terror, because there are certain points in which we basically have a blind spot where we don't know exactly what's happening as the rover plummets through Mars' atmosphere. And so while we have been extremely successful with previous landings, there is still a lot of danger in any harm coming to the craft. There are lots of systems in place to help the craft slow down, to help ensure that it will not crash, that it will be safe, but it is still a danger and something that scientists have to take into account when planning a mission like this. All right, next question. Okay, Josh on Facebook asks, do we really think there are aliens on Mars? Maybe. I'm going to be careful here because I know that people have a lot of different opinions about life on Mars, right? We've been talking about Martians and life on Mars since the earliest days of sci-fi movie making last century. But as the science has grown and as we continue to understand more and more about Mars, it had a magnetic field. It had a thick, lush atmosphere. It had liquid water. It had huge oceans and rivers and deltas and streams. It had volcanic activity. It had all of these things that if we saw them happening on Mars today, we would say, hey, that looks a lot like Earth. And, you know, while things have happened on Mars that have clearly changed that, its magnetic field was stripped away, and then solar wind from our sun stripped away the particles in its atmosphere, leaving Mars cold and pretty desolate with a really thin, it has an atmosphere, a really thin atmosphere, but scientists do think that at some point in time, it's likely that there was life on Mars. Now, what that life looked like exactly, I can't say. I can't say that life on Mars at any point in time likely or unlikely looked like anything we've ever seen in science fiction. In fact, scientists think that if there was or potentially even is life on Mars, that it's likely microscopic and probably looks a little bit like the extremophiles we see on Earth. Things like tardigrades, microscopic organisms that live in hydrothermal vents, in and around volcanoes, in these extreme conditions on Earth that we think should have been able to survive those environments on Mars if that life was present. So I can't say whether or not there was ever life on Mars, that's what Perseverance is going to go find out, but we think that it's possible that there could have been at some point in time. It's a lot less likely that there is still life on Mars today, but that doesn't mean that it's completely impossible. The planet is extremely cold, but it does have a little bit of liquid water and a little bit of water in its atmosphere and water ice at its poles. It has a few of the components that we align with life here on Earth, so while unlikely, and while that life, if it exists, probably exists far, far underground where it's safe from the radiation, it's not completely impossible. So hopefully Perseverance will answer some of those questions for us. Okay, I have a couple of questions here along the same lines. People are asking, why do we need to occupy Mars? Why haven't we explored our oceans yet completely, but we're still flying to Mars when space travel isn't even all that capable yet? Why are we doing this? Why are we doing this? Why are we doing this? I understand. So it's a really challenging question. And I think the greatest example of this is if we look back to the Apollo program, when we went to the moon. Why did we go to the moon? Obviously, there were political reasons why we rushed it and made it happen as quickly as we did. But I think in a larger way, going to the moon really advanced science and society. In terms of science, while we're not all walking around in spacesuits and moon boots, a lot of the technology that was invented to get humans on the moon's surface helps us today on Earth in extraordinary ways. Things like CAT scan machines, things like running shoes, everyday technologies, the phones in our pockets have all been helped and pushed forward, and some even completely invented with the inspiration and help of technologies created for Apollo. So while obviously as humans we have this innate need and desire to explore that kind of is the basis for all that we do scientifically and exploration-wise, in a practical way, going to Mars to make that possible, to one day land humans on Mars, we'll need to invent and we'll need to be innovative in ways that we have never been before. And so while we'll see those technologies play out with just a few people on Mars, those technologies can come right back home and hopefully help us here on Earth like we saw with Apollo. So not everyone is going to want a ticket to Mars, obviously, and we may never have huge civilizations on Mars like we do here on Earth, but I think that if we look at it as if we looked at going to the moon, as we're trying to go back to the moon now, I think it's easy to see the value in pushing ourselves to the extreme in terms of innovation. So, hope that answers your question. All right, someone asks, would you consider establishing a space station orbiting Mars before creating a settlement on the surface? This is an interesting question. So space stations orbiting other planets or satellites like moons have definitely been considered, and people have considered them for Mars as well. I don't know if I would consider establishing one because I'm not personally in a position to establish a space station anywhere, as cool as that would be. But I do know that NASA is working specifically on an orbiting station not around Mars, but around the moon to help us get to Mars. You've probably heard it referred to as the Gateway, or the Lunar Orbiting Gateway. It's gone by many names. But the Gateway is basically an orbiting station around our moon. Now, how does this factor in with Mars? Basically, our goal with Artemis, with NASA, to get back to the moon is to use the moon as a stepping stone to get to Mars. Both in terms of testing technology and literally as a stepping stone, the moon is going to be an invaluable piece in getting humans to Mars' surface. And so with a station around the moon, astronauts can, you know, travel up and back from the station for supplies to more easily get back to Earth, etc. So while the Gateway isn't going to be around Mars, it could support future Martian missions. Great question. All right. People are wondering, how likely is it that a crewed mission to Mars could actually be successful? That's a great question. And I think that we can really just look to our uncrewed missions. And at least with NASA, and as we're seeing with China, with the UAE, it's becoming more and more possible to land robots on the surface of Mars, to put robotic orbiters around Mars in its orbit. And so as we continue to show how that's more possible, and like I said before, as we show how we can return humans to the moon, I think that we have a pretty good chance of success. I can't say when that will happen. I know that NASA, SpaceX, everyone has a different timeline that they're hoping to get to Mars by, but I do think that whatever the timeline may be, if it takes much longer than they anticipate or not, I do think it's possible. All right, someone's asking about lava tubes on Mars. This is a great question. Someone's wondering, what's the evidence of lava tubes on Mars that would make a pretty interesting living environment? Yes, so there are lava tubes on Mars that we have detected. And in fact, we've found some pretty big lava tubes on Mars. So big that, you're right, we're considering having that where people... we're considering putting people in those lava tubes. You know, without a thick atmosphere and a magnetic field, Mars' surface is extremely, extremely prone to radiation. You know, we're protected here on Earth, our thick atmosphere, our magnetic field, that we only get a little bit of radiation from the sun, but on the surface of Mars, it would be extremely, extremely dangerous for humans. So while we can put people in spacesuits and put them in habitats, by putting people underground in Martian lava tubes, it just adds that extra layer of protection between the humans and that radiation. So yes, agencies like NASA are definitely looking at the possibility of exploring what it would mean to create a Martian habitat underground. Great question. Okay, let's see. A lot of people are talking about Elon, yes. A lot of people think that Elon's going to be the first to land humans on Mars. I don't know. I know that NASA is also very hard at work trying to get to Mars. I know a lot of people are hard at work trying to get to Mars. I'm curious what you think. Comment down below who you think is going to get to Mars first. I don't want to incite anything. I just think it's an interesting conversation. Okay. How could we terraform Mars? Could bacteria be used to terraform Mars? This is a great question. Terraforming is a pretty controversial topic because while we've seen it in science fiction for a long time, it still remains a huge question whether terraforming a planet in general is even possible. So whether or not we're using bacteria or something else to terraform, I don't know if it's possible. I don't know. But as we've seen with science fiction things like The Martian, bacteria could be used in interesting ways on Mars. So if you haven't seen or read The Martian, the lead character, Mark Watney, he fertilizes, using human waste, he fertilizes the Martian soil with that human incubated bacteria and other materials to essentially kind of terraform, in a very tiny way, little bits of Martian soil so that he could grow plants for food. And experiments like that are definitely something that scientists are looking at, because if we're going to have humans on Mars for an extended period of time, we want them to be able to eat and to be able to have the correct nutrition. So using bacteria in a way that helps us grow crops is absolutely something scientists are exploring. All right, let's see. Okay, got one more question, and then we're going to move to our last section. That's right, Space Chat is expanding. We have a whole other section now. So the last question of today is, how does Mars maintain its orbit around the Sun without a magnetic field? This is a great question. And the interesting answer is, it doesn't need one. In fact, while a lot of planets do have magnetic fields, like Earth, like we live on, not all planets have magnetic fields, but that doesn't inhibit their ability to orbit around whatever star they are orbiting. It just really changes the environment of a planet, as it does not protect that planet's surface as well from solar radiation. So by losing its magnetic field, Mars' atmosphere was then vulnerable to being stripped away by the solar wind, which has changed Mars dramatically and forever. But that didn't change that it's orbiting around the Sun. It continues to orbit around the Sun and will do so for quite some time. All right, so those are all the questions I had to get through. Again, at any time throughout the week, you can tweet at us, send us a message, send us an email with your questions, and every week I will answer as many as I can. So this gets us to our last section of Space Chat, what's new in space? And this week was a busy week in space. As I mentioned, the UAE and China both had missions arrive at the Red Planet. In addition to these major Mars missions, scientists spotted a potentially habitable exoplanet candidate orbiting around Alpha Centauri A, which is the closest star system to our own solar system. So this was a really, really exciting discovery. Additionally, NASA chose SpaceX's Falcon Heavy rocket to launch the first pieces of the agency's planned lunar gateway around the moon. I mentioned this a couple minutes ago, but this is planned to be an orbiting lunar outpost. So Falcon Heavy is going to carry the first pieces of it to the moon, which is very exciting. Speaking of SpaceX, Elon Musk just unveiled a $100 million XPRIZE carbon capture contest, hoping to inspire and incentivize people to innovate new carbon capture and removal technology. Also, recently, scientists working at the Large Hadron Collider in Switzerland found the first evidence for a very rare type of decay with the Higgs boson particle. This is a major scientific step forward, jumping off of the discovery of the Higgs boson, the first full detection of the Higgs boson back in 2012. So that's all for this week. Stay tuned right here at space.com as we continue on in the month of Mars, eagerly awaiting Perseverance's arrival at the Red Planet.